Hello, I'm Paul.
I'm Adam.
And I'm Ben.
And welcome to the Film Busters podcast. The film show with no filters, no prisoners taken, loads of disagreements, but one hell of a love for cinema.
If you want to hear three friends ridiculing each other for an hour or so regarding their taste in films, then you have come to the right place.
In each episode, one of the team picks a film for us to discuss. It could be anything from a recent cinema release to an all-time classic.
So, strap in and get ready to get mad or get vindicated as we guide you through the murky world of being a film geek.
If you like what you hear, you can also find us on Twitter and Instagram using @FilmBustersPod. You can also find each of our individual accounts. I'm at FilmBustersPaul.
I'm at FilmBustersAdam.
And I'm at FilmBustersBen.
If you want to use your eyes instead of your ears, you can also visit the website at filmbusterspod.co.uk.
And if busting makes you feel good, you can also support us at patreon.com/filmbusters for exclusive content.
All right, can we just get on with this now, please?
Filmbusters. Adam, we've missed you so much. Where have you been?
I've been here. I just haven't been here. I haven't been anywhere, really. I've been busy.
What have you been busy with? Come on.
I missed out the JB record because I got called into work because loads of stuff happened.
Mm-hmm.
And
this is the stuff I don't care about. I'm waiting for you to tell us one thing that we want to speak about.
I've got a dog. So if you watch the Patreon recording this afternoon on live, I'd probably put him in front of the camera.
Oh, lovely.
I'm going to leave him for the moment because he's currently sleeping in his cage. And if I awake him, he might...
If I wake him, sounds like a demon.
It can be that sometimes. Cage. When he's peace,
in his cage.
It doesn't take a lot for him to suddenly go puppy mode and start trying to eat cables and stuff.
Well, this is very sweet. What's the name of your little puppy, Adam?
He's called Mocha. And
very hard
for
us to work out how he pronounced that name over it's WhatsApp not, messages.
Yeah. Well, it could be Mocha. That's the thing.
It could have been Mocha.
Some people say Mocha.
Francis, one of our patrons, keeps calling him Mocha.
Yeah, some people call him Mocha. Some people say Mocha. I used to say Mocha. And why did you get this dog?
Because dogs are adorable.
Why did you get this dog?
Yeah, me and Gavin wanted the dog for a very long time, and we looked at a website and we adopted him from a family that were giving him away. So,
do you feel adorable. Responsible? Do you feel like you can be responsible for a life?
Yeah, I mean they're quite easy and also very hard at the same time. It's like
quite easy, he says. They're definitely not easy.
But there's like elements of like the first
you were
week.
Hoping they'd be easy, and then you realise they're not.
Well, the first week was a bit more chaotic but now he's settled into his environment. He does a lot more things by himself, and he can be left alone. And
dear listeners, this gentleman got a dog on Saturday. In the first 7 days. Of having the little dog on his Instagram. And for those of you who follow him on Instagram, you will attest to this. Almost every evening, or every day, there was a video of him in some corner of the country doing some event that did not involve that dog and could not involve that dog because some of it was gigs, some of it was golf.
I literally went and played golf once and went to a gig once.
You went to several gigs.
I went to one gig.
You went to a beer festival.
You went to a beer festival, yes.
So he can be
left.
You went
to Brighton.
I went to Dorking in the end. That was to play golf.
You are a Dorking, mate.
But you are a Dorking.
He was left at home with Chelsea those days, and my parents were with him on Thursday. Only when we left him alone was on the beer festival, but he needs to be learned to be left alone, so...
Very traumatised, this dog. Tough love from Adam. Tough love.
You can't baby him from the beginning because then they expect baby him.
That poor single mother at home you've just left with the child.
He's a brute. But it's true, we've had two episodes without Adam. We've had Saw X and Aliens, and now you're back with us for Jeff Goldblum's The Fly.
Absolutely.
Or David Cronenberg's The Fly. Or Gina Davis, The Fly.
Yeah, it's lovely to have you back, Adam, and we are very excited to meet the dog one day.
Yes, he will be. He'll be on Patreon later on, so you can sign up for £1 to see the dog's face.
Wouldn't it be crazy to have Memphis, Mocha and Maxie in the same room?
It would. Max would hate it.
Maxie would hate it.
If we put them all on camera and it's all three of them staring at each other, and none of us are there.
In front of the Blue Yeti mics.
Yeah. We should try. We should try for sure. At some point, we should try that.
And the people just tune into the Patreon, and it's just all of our pets just staring at each other. They're like, what the fuck has gone on here?
Oh, if you could do an audio edit over our pets, Paul, so that we're talking like this, but what you see is our pets.
And their mouths are opening.
Prop that peanut butter in their mouth.
I just gave him some peanut butter and a little conch.
It's called a Kong, by the way.
Kong, is it?
Kong.
Kong, Kong, whatever.
You're very fresh, this. It's called a Kong.
It keeps them happy.
Of course it does.
Well, wonderful stuff. So happy for you, Adam. Very lovely. Yes, everyone. Today we're doing The Fly. This is my pick from 1986. We're in the 1986 round. It's the second film of 1986. No, it's my pick.
Oh.
And, yeah, I'm looking forward to speaking about this, but first of all, I guess we've got to talk about our patron, www.patreon.com/filmbusters, where you can get exclusive episodes, you can suggest films for us to do, you can come on the show, and you can just get some lovely stuff over there with our lovely Filmbusters family.
Yeah.
Adam, what are we doing on the Patreon after this episode today?
We are doing our monthly roundup, so we talk about all our favourite films from October, even though there's still, when we're recording this, there's still a week left of October, so the first 3 weeks of October, I guess.
Yeah, and that means, just to clarify, that means when we do our November roundup, we're allowed to talk about what we watch in these remaining days of October.
Yes, but not, well, we can't just pick what we want to watch. It's those remaining days, Paul.
Correct.
Listen, that's what I did last time, but you didn't allow me.
No, it's from the last record. You were just doing it from, like, whenever.
Listen, it's fine. You do make the rules whatever you want it to be. It's fine. It's okay.
Yeah, because I am going to see a film tonight, and I can imagine the film tonight I'm going to see will probably be not only top of my month, but top of my year.
Or maybe it won't be. Or maybe it won't be.
Or maybe it won't be, yeah.
It might not be. I'm also going to see that same film, but this afternoon.
Are you?
Yes.
What time are you going?
3:15.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm going at 7 o'clock. It's a brand new
I'll come out and I'll spoil the ending. Yeah.
As you come out, I'll be going in. Was it 3:40, isn't it, or something?
3:30, yeah.
Fuck me, man.
I know, that is long.
I hope this picture house has comfortable seats.
Oh, are you going to the new one in Ealing?
Yeah.
I'm going to the West Norwood one.
Yeah, it's about a 2-minute walk from my house. I can't really not go.
It's crazy how things have changed, right? When people were, like, saying how bad it was about The Irishman, I guess because it was going on stream though, wasn't it? That's why they didn't want to put it in cinemas, but I was so happy I got to see it in the cinema.
Yeah, same.
Yeah,
exactly. I mean, even this is an Apple film, I think it goes onto Apple in January, but that's a good enough time, that's like more. I think even Disney don't even give it that long these days, but
well, that's very exciting.
Yeah, it is exciting. Anyway, we're not here to talk about Flowers of the Killing Moon.
Is that
Killers of the Flower Moon,
whatever it's called,
whatever that damn film's called. Yes, we're here to talk about The Fly, everyone. But before that, we gotta somehow go towards talking about The Fly and do our quiz about The Fly, Adam.
Yes, you ready to do the quiz about The Fly?
I'm ready to do the quiz about The Fly.
I'm about to ask these guys two questions. If they get the point, if they get it right, they get the point. If they get it wrong, I get the point. The scores currently stand. It's a little bit closer than when I last was here. I think so anyway. Paul has 25.5, I have 22, and Ben has 20.5 points. Are you ready for question number one?
Yes.
Let's do it.
Whose music is Brundle playing on the piano at the beginning of the film?
Mozart?
Wrong.
Beethoven.
Correct, Ben.
Oh,
That was a guess.
It says on the piano. If you look on the piano, it has a book that says the works of Beethoven, and then he's opened it.
Well done, well done.
Do you know what, Paul? I wouldn't have even guessed classical. It's only because you said Mozart. I thought it was going to be like some contemporary act or contemporary for the 80s.
I remember it being something classical, but I just didn't know. I can't remember what song it was.
If I get this right, I'm about to come out of last place for the first time this year.
Oh, yeah, baby, yeah.
Okay, are you ready? This one's a little bit more of a... I might let you have this within 1 point. I'll decide about how close you are. At one point, he's putting sugars into his coffee. And she says,
that's a good question.
Do you want any sugar coffee with your sugar? How many sugars does he put into his coffee?
That's a very good question. That's a very good question.
And by the way, I don't know the answer to this. I was counting it in the film. So.
Okay.
So you do know the answer to it?
Well, I do, but at the same time, it's me counting rather than.
So it's probably wrong.
No, I think it's right. But
Who is going to take a guess first?
I'm going to say 7.
Yeah, that feels about right. But Adam, what's the rules in, like, if we're close, I'll within decide. How many?
I'll decide basically.
So if you did like 2 points away from me, and it's like the one in the middle, we both get half a point.
All right. Yeah. Well, I'm gonna say 10.
Okay. Well, one of you was 1 out. It was 8.
Yes! Oh, of course. See, I would have loved to have said 7, but what was the point of splitting the points? I gave Paul that point, basically.
Yeah. I said it first.
You're going to have half a point, Paul, and I'll get the other half a point, and then everyone's got half a point.
But you said you get a point.
I'm joking. No, I don't care, to be honest.
At least Paul's now on a round number, though.
Yeah.
He's on...
And you're
he's not, because he got a full point.
I got 26.5.
Yes, he did. 26.5 for you. 22 for Adam, 21.5 for Rye.
There we go. Well,
good question.
I'm glad we're this. Yeah, that was a very good question. I never.
I think that was the best question of the year.
Yeah, that was a very, very good question.
Yeah.
Very good. Well, should we go talk about the flight now?
Yes, let's
do it. Let's talk about it.
Have you ever heard of insect politics? Neither have I. Insects don't have politics. They're very brutal. No compassion. No compromise. We can't trust the insect. I'd like to become the first insect politician. You see, I'd like to, but... Oh, I'm afraid.
I don't know what you're trying to say.
I'm saying. I'm saying I'm an insect who dreamt he was a man and loved it. But now the dream is over and the insect is awake.
Hello everyone, yes, we're talking about The Fly from 1986 by David Cronenberg. This is a spoiler episode, we'll go straight into spoilers, no hanging around. So if you've not seen the film, you want to go watch it first and then come back and listen to us. Right, there are 3 people who have been in films we have done before, all actors. We have not done a David Cronenberg directed film.
So David Cronenberg was in Jason X.
Yes, correct, there we go.
Jeff Goldblum was obviously in, what was the one that... Ben picked.
Come on.
Deep
remember
Cover.
The name. Deep Cover
yes.
And...
That Jurassic Park one.
Yes. Fallen Kingdom. Yes. One person. One more person. And it's in a film we did... was it the beginning of this year?
I'm guessing it's Gina Davis?
No, it's not. It's the male.
Oh, was it the other guy, the editor?
Yes.
I don't... What's his name? John Getz?
John Getz, yes. I don't know. I get it.
I don't know what he was in.
So he was the newspaper boss in Zodiac.
That's really random.
Yeah. Once you see him, they'd be like, oh yeah, that's his face. I would never have got it though.
No,
but yeah,
no.
That's it. That's the 3 people. So Adam, tell us the plot.
So this film is about Jeff Goldblum, who is a scientist, or Brundlefly. Or Brundle, and then he becomes Brundlefly.
Mm.
He goes to, he invents a teleportation machine, and when he's teleporting himself, eventually a fly gets involved in the machine, and they basically bond. And over the rest of the film, he slowly becomes a fly.
What do they bond over?
I don't know.
Yeah, what do they bond over? Mutual
fishing?
Interests and stuff.
Science. They both like science and they both like sugar.
They do.
But this is quite the opposite to the way Bart Simpson turns into the fly in the Treehouse of Terror episode.
Ah, yes, very good.
Of course there had to be Simpsons.
Of course the Simpsons have done this.
We should try and find a Simpsons connection to every episode we do.
Isn't that for your reference, his job?
That is. Actually, I believe it's Contrarian's job because Alex always references the Simpsons in almost every episode.
Go on, Ben. What you got?
That was good. Well, as you might expect, there is shitloads of information and backstory on this one, so I couldn't cover everything. So I'll just do some top notes. So The Fly is David Cronenberg's 1986 remake of Vincent Price's 1958 film, which was in turn based on George Langerland's 1957 short story of the same name. A guy called Charles Edward Pogue wrote the first draft of the screenplay, and he chose to focus on the gradual transformation from man to fly rather than the instant transformation that the original did. But 20th Century Fox so disliked the draft that they withdrew their commitment to producing the film, and it was only when Mel Brooks, comedic personality Mel Brooks, came on board as a financier of the project that they decided and agreed that they would distribute it. And because Brooks was so well known for his comedy films, his name was left off of the credits to ensure that the film was taken seriously. However, he did not like Pogue's script, so he sent it to another guy called Wallen Green, who was hired to rewrite it. And then when this guy rewrote it, Brooks said, "I don't like that." So he brought back the original writer again to tidy it up. And then when they approached Cronenberg to direct it, he had to drop out of doing Total Recall. He was going to be directing a version of Total Recall at the time, so he couldn't commit to it.
Total Recall, or any version of it.
Yes, he was doing it with a different cast, different style and all of that. But anyway, he departed that project, but he didn't like the script, so he rewrote the script. And by the end of the film, there was only one line of dialogue that had survived from the original version of the script that this guy, Pogue, wrote. But how nice is this? Cronenberg insisted that this guy Pogue got a co-writing credit in the films because he said without his blueprint the story wouldn't exist at all. So even though that guy only had one fucking line of dialogue in the whole script, he's listed as a co-writer.
Nice.
Mel Brooks wanted Pierce Brosnan to play the role of Seth Brundle, but Cronenberg didn't like that. John Malkovich was then the next choice, but he declined. John Lithgow was offered the role, but he turned it down, saying it was too grotesque. Michael Keaton and Richard Dreyfuss were considered, but Richard Dreyfuss refused to wear prosthetics. And finally, Jeff Goldblum was proposed by Cronenberg because he was willing to take it all on. And then, because because Goldblum was dating Gina Davis at the time, he recommended her for the female lead, and Cronenberg was in agreement. There's many other things. God, there's so much. I'm not going to say much more. There's multiple different endings of the film, which we can talk about later as well. This one's the best, though. And the film won an Academy Award for Best Makeup at the time. So in a year when...
Was it in classes like special effects or prosthetics?
Well, it was called makeup at the time, and I guess it is makeup because rather than special effects, I guess there is like a little bit of puppetry in there. But largely it's latex being layered over the top of him, etc., isn't it?
Isn't it called makeup and hairstyling now?
Possibly.
Isn't that what the award's
called? Hair and makeup, or whatever.
Hair and makeup, maybe. Yeah.
Right, so this is my film, so I get to decide the order of first impressions. I think I am going to go first. We'll just do film buses order. This is two film buses order. Okay, so this is actually only the second time I've actually watched this film, surprisingly, but it has been calling to me to return since my watch. I think it was back in 2019 when I watched it. So I did not have any. I don't have no nostalgia for this film. So there's none of that. But surprise, surprise, I loved it even more this time around. Not to say I didn't think it was like great to start off with from the first watch. I did, but it was a really great time. This must be like the best use of Jeff Goldblum's personality put towards a character. Just like the erratic energy, the tendency to go off on tangents. It just feels like him in real life, and it feels like he's just wonderful in it. The effects are absolutely masterful. Not surprised they won, especially considering they're almost 40 years old. They haven't aged a day. Their perfection,
just like me,
icky, horrendous. What, this vomit inducing? that's what I was going to say. It's so horrible, visceral, but I love it. It's great. The story's tight. It's a brilliant length. It's surprising how long it takes for Brundle Fly to actually start happening, though. But it just goes to show how much there is to enjoy just about Goldblum and Davis together. But it's the best Cronenberg film. Yeah, that's my first impressions.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Yeah, I think I fully agree with everything Paul said there. It's a great film. It's, again, it's tight, it's quick, it's straight to the point. Doesn't really mess around. It's entertaining, it's fun. Like the effects and everything, or makeup, whatever you want to call it, is incredible, really. Yeah, you can't really knock it, but yeah, and it's only the second time I've ever seen it as well.
Wow.
Yeah, it's just kind of great film of that kind of era. You could kind of see like the theme running between Alien and this, though, that kind of, it was almost like a dirty kind of look to the film, isn't it? It's almost dusty. It's almost like there's a slight haze or a fog in the room at all time. But yeah, it's a great film. Very clean, very to the point. And you can't really knock it.
Nice, clean, in and out. I've seen it many, many times. I'd said already in the Aliens episode that I gave... So this shows my hand, but I said that Aliens was a 10 out of 10 film, and there was only one film, as far as I was concerned, from 1986 that was better than it, and it's this film. I adore it. Also, it is absolutely tight. It is absolutely Cronenberg's best film for many, many reasons. It is Goldblum. It's his best film, 100%.
It's Goldblum.
Yeah, I know. I was getting
over Jurassic Park, Fallen Kingdom.
Yeah, it was tight between this and Fallen Kingdom, I must admit.
Fallen Kingdom.
I must admit that 10-second masterclass that he put on in Fallen Kingdom. Mm. But it is a joy. It's a brilliant film to watch from on a surface level, anyway, just as this horror sci-fi, which it is. But what I love most about it is this core... Romance is too stupid a word to use for it, but it is... romantic, this relationship between him and Gina Davis, and it's the power of that relationship in this film and what happens to it by the end, which is why this film is so effective for me, because despite how ridiculous the concept is, a man turning into a fly and everything that we see with the vomit and whatnot and body parts falling off, which is great, the fact that you can then take your subject matter so seriously to the point where that climax happens and it's heartbreaking is brilliant. Because it would be far, far easier to just do a grotesque, here we go, turning into a fly type, shocky, fun thing. But it was saying much more. Very devastating ending, which stays with me and is always what I remember most about the film. But on this viewing, also, I saw a hell of a lot more in there about bodies. Like Cronenberg obviously has this obsession with the flesh anyway. In all of his films, he likes to merge flesh and machine, flesh and something. More often than not, flesh and the machine, which is what happened here. Even though it was a fly, he has to go through a machine to transform. But this, to me, felt like the most cautious of Cronenberg's films about technology. But also, it was his most astute and most thought-provoking film when it came to what the flesh really means for humans, and that by that I mean aging, disease, ownership of bodies. There's a lot of stuff in there which is very, very interesting, and I adore it, and I'm not even going to make any bones about it. It's the best film from 1986, and it is better than Aliens. As great as Aliens is, this is the superior of the two.
Wow.
If you were picking a film from 1986, this would be your best film?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Interesting. Wonderful.
Interesting.
I can't wait to dig into all this stuff you've uncovered in this film on this watch.
Why not? It's not like anything is massively hidden, but the thing that I... Let's have a look at this, for example. For you two, that ending scene, right?
Yeah.
Does that feel very sad? And very heartbreaking for you.
Yeah, absolutely. Because you can tell in Gina's face, it's like she's built up this relationship, and this whole thing has fallen apart. And to see this man who she really quite adored just in front of her, just completely removed from what he was.
Yeah,
and still carrying his baby, but doesn't want the baby because she doesn't want to have this kind of monster.
Is this the one about the baby?
Yes, but we discount that because nobody wants to be tied to that. It basically undoes... Gina Davis isn't in it, no.
Okay, good. Yeah.
Is it an awful film?
Yeah, it truly is.
Is Cronenberg doing it as well?
No, nobody who was involved in this film was involved in that.
How long was left in between it?
I can't remember. Something like 4 or 5 years, maybe.
Oh, okay.
It's awful. It has no connection to it. Okay. It shouldn't be connected to this. Because it takes away the ambiguity of this ending, which is what happens. Yeah. Does she keep the baby or not? Mm. The sequel's like, yeah, she keeps it. And it's born, and it is fly-like. It's like, oh.
3 years later, it was.
There you go. But that emotional feeling in the end, that's pretty incredible to accomplish, considering what you've shown us in this film, which is a man crawling up the walls in a Phantom of the Opera style dramatic horrific way, vomiting up. To ask us to take that stuff seriously and then also take that tragic ending seriously, I think is only accomplished because of all the incredible work that he does in the build-up to him becoming Brundlefly. As you say, Paul, it takes a while for him to become Brundlefly, and it's because you believe that connection between Jeff Goldblum and Gina Davis.
I think that's the incredible bit thing about it, is that you, in a film like this, you'd expect to not like the... it's not necessarily he's a villain, but he is the kind of villain by the end that they're trying to get rid of. But because you've built up this kind of relationship and seen their relationship grow together, and Jeff Goldblum's just so likable, by the end you never feel so malice towards the character. It's like, oh man, how did you get here, kind of thing.
I know,
but that's not to say the stuff we see throughout, like the amazing practical effects, aren't something to draw you to the film as well, because I think they're so well done, and they haven't aged a day, man. They just look so good, and you could watch a film in the 90s with practical effects and they just look shoddy.
Yeah,
we're here, like the whole him at the end as the fly, it's just solid.
It's so solid, really, really solid.
And to the bit where he's transforming into like the last stage of being a fly, and how the whole like head breaks open and the skin's falling off, and it's like, wow, man, that is some great piece of work right there. That's art.
It's very, very well done. I was thinking the other day, the problem with CGI now as opposed to CGI when it was used in, say, the 90s, right, is say something like Terminator 2. When you use Terminator 2, blending practical effects with CGI effects, right?
Yeah.
Back then, it knew its limitations, so it didn't try to do too much with CGI, so it worked. Yeah. But nowadays, they think CGI
is the answer
is beyond
to
where it is. Yeah. They think that it is the be-all and end-all, and it's not. It hasn't evolved to the point where it can be used well enough. So they use it in films now, and it completely disconnects people because they're aware that what they're watching is fake. Whereas when you see that Jeff Goldblum split apart and the fly come out of it, obviously on an unconscious level, you know it's fake. But for the purpose of the film, you believe that that's happening, which just doesn't happen nowadays with special effects. I really can't see that happening in big budget films now.
Well, I think it's the biggest crime in the 90s, really, because that's when they really led into, oh, look at this CGI, man. It's like, look, this is going to age so well. And it's like, no, none of it has. It's just like people overuse it so much. I think there are films nowadays that can pass. I mean, if you're looking at, look at Avatar, the whole thing is CGI, and you can still enjoy the ride of it because it's the technology has come so far. But back in the 90s, that was when everyone was leaning so heavily into it. It's like, man, it just doesn't work.
Mm.
It's all about the practical.
So it's interesting you say that, because I think the 90s is okay time for CGI because it isn't used a hell of a lot. It's used too much now.
There's some bad shit there.
Go on, give an example.
I can't think of an example right now. Okay.
I know, but do you want an example of bad CGI from now? Every Marvel film.
The Mummy Returns.
Oh, yeah, the fucking Rock.
Yeah, okay, when did The Mummy Returns come out? I bet that was
early
2000s.
I even watched fucking Now You See Me the other day, and there's like a scene in it when they first go into the house, and there's like water run through the floor. And you're like, this water is CGI. Like, you can run water through a floorboard. Like,
Yeah.
But that's looks, you know, that's 21st century. Yeah.
The Mummy Returns was 2001, but my point is 21st
century.
Because even the first Mummy, the Mummy film, the Mummy was CGI as well. So, and that doesn't hold up.
I also think that era of like 2000 and like 95 to like 2005, when you had like Lord of the Rings, Star Wars, and the Mummy, it was like the verge of like HD almost, or like better quality cameras, and like they came before the better quality CGI came, so it was quite obvious. It put another emphasis on top of how bad that CGI was, and I think it took a couple, especially when they had such big budgets to do everything in CGI as well. It's kind of like
I think, well, especially now, because the fact that we're getting all these 4K restorations, and that is never going to hold up when you're putting this CGI from those films into 4K quality.
Yeah. No. Whereas the practical effects always will, because it's something tangible that was right in front of the camera. Yeah.
Also, I think it looks better the more emphasis you put on it, because it's like it enhances the craftsmanship almost of like what they did. And you want it to be a bit shit. Like, you want it to be like a Halloween costume or like your pumpkin in your house. It's better to have one that you carved yourself than buy one from a shop.
Yeah, it's better to do that than buy a plastic one that's made. Yeah. It's that moment when, right at the end of the film, when he's fully transformed into the fly and he backs into the pod, and he's kind of like twitching a little bit, and his mandible is sort of like flickering around. That feels real. It's crazy, but it feels real. You believe that is a fly, and it's unsettling because of that. If that was some CGI thing, it's like you just wouldn't buy it. Anyway, no wonder it won an Academy Award. I'm so glad that this film won an Academy Award. The fact that it did shows how things did used to be fucking better.
Yeah. I think that's the thing, isn't it? It's, you can be in the room. I think that's the difference. You know, you could be in the room with that fly because it's a real tangible thing. Whereas CGI, it's like, well, nothing's really there.
So no, exactly.
Why should I be scared of it, kind of thing?
Yeah, exactly. I can't think of a scary CGI thing.
The level of detail, like, especially if you're watching like in HD now, just up close, you can see the level of detail that's gone into making these puppets and this practical effects. Amazing.
That's what I mean. It gets better the more you see it.
And also, Adam's just knocked over a glass.
Should move my chair.
More than just that as well, that final fly thing, it was how sickly they made Goldblum look as the film progressed as well. That was very good. Like, the whole thing, there were apparently 7 stages of the transformation, and they had different makeup and effects for the 7 different stages. Like, the first one was the sort of rash skin discoloration. They were the first 2 evolutions of that. The 3rd and 4th stage were the sort of bald spots, the teeth, the nails coming off. The next one was that sort of bodysuit, which had deformities in different areas, but not completely. The next was that full creature, and then the next was that telepod fusion at the end. Like, all of that is incredible. Like, something like that needs to be acknowledged. Did you know that... a lot of people read the way that he looked with the lesions and whatnot as an analogy for AIDS, and people thought that Cronenberg was telling a story about the AIDS epidemic at the time.
It was around that time, wasn't it?
Yes.
Wow, yeah, makes sense.
And the fact that, you know, when Gina Davis comes around, he's like, stay away from me. I don't know if this is contagious, etc., whatnot.
Has it ever been confirmed that it was, or...?
No, in fact, he said that he's heard people say that, and he never saw it that way. He saw it more as...
I mean, I never saw it that way until, but I guess at the time when everyone's like, if a film came out during COVID, everything, you'd have been like, oh,
trying to make that link. Yeah,
he said it was more about disease and aging overall. That's what that it was about. It was about disease and aging and the loss of.
I thought it was just don't fuck with science.
Well, that too, yes. That too.
I think that especially that scene as well, where he comes out on the like the walking sticks, that just adds even more that level of empathy towards the character, because he's broken down to like this frail man speaking about like fly politics and stuff like that, and it's like he's almost like he's deluded, and Gina Davis there like, this man's gone, like, what has happened? How's it gone this far? And it's so like, there is a level, so much empathy there. for that character. Yeah. You could, and you get that from Dina as well. It almost helps you along with the ride that you're kind of along in her headspace as well.
I know.
Very good.
I want to tell you that Gina Davis is superb in this film. Because
and you don't like her.
It's not that I don't like her. Normally, I don't find her very engaging. Mm. But in this, she is perfect. And this film cannot be told without her character. It only works because her character is there at the heart of it as well.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
You completely... every emotional beat that she has to do, you buy. You believe it.
Yeah,
and
sure.
I would almost say that she is your point of contact throughout this film rather than Jeff Goldblum.
Yeah.
Because you're kept at such an arm's length from what Goldblum's doing because it's so extreme. Your one relatable person in here is Gina. Even though
absolutely.
The film ends when Goldblum dies, it's like, well, that's his story
well,
done.
Mercy.
We're done.
It's mercy, though, from her part.
It is mercy from her part, yeah. What of AI? Because when he starts entering that stuff into the computer, I immediately started thinking AI here. It's like Cronenberg predicting the future where people are like, you know how AI gets it fucking wrong now. If you go in these things like ChatGPT or whatever and you say, create a David Lynch version of a Friends episode and they do an image or something and you're like, it's not quite right. Like, things are blurred and kind of grotesque, particularly when it's images. It's
that
grotesque
uncanny valley
they haven't
kind of
quite
thing.
Gone. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. That is what these pods were, when it was like, I have a fly in here and a human. I guess this is what it should be. It's like, no. You got it wrong. Mm. You don't understand, like they keep talking about, you don't understand the flesh. You don't understand what it is to be human. Computer's never going to really understand that. Is never going to get that. That's why these fucking songs that they create, these poems that they create, these scripts that they create are never going to be good because they don't understand what it is to be human.
It's soulless, isn't it? There's no soul there.
And no soul, yeah.
When Brundle goes in the machine with his fly, it's just like, I assume, I've just got to put them together.
Yeah.
Because that's obviously clearly what he wants. He's put this in the machine, so I'm just fusing them together. That's what he wants. I'm just making my own assumption there. It's like, no. Why would he want that?
It's so that, and I love how the computer is used to give us the explanations along the way. It does it in a very clever way because it knows that it could be very complicated with science, but every time they come back to the computer, it's very basic and it allows you to understand. But that revelation where he's typing, trying to understand, and the computer's giving him the answers, that's quite horrific.
And it's just elementary answers. Yeah. It's just like the most basic answers. It's like, considering this machine just combined like mega science, it's like, I'm just giving you really, I just combined a fly and a man. That's what you want, Brundle fly.
Yeah. And he is absolutely brilliant all the way through.
Mm-hmm.
Jeff.
Yep,
Jeff he's absolutely peak Jeff Goldblum. As you say, there's so many hand gestures which are Jeff Goldblum, fingers wagging in the air. There's a point when she says something like, I can't remember what she says. She comes over to his apartment not long after the experiment and she says something like, I think you might be turning into something else, something not a man. And he just wags his finger in the air and he goes, very good, yes. You're dying, man. Don't be so glib about it.
He is very good. He's very, very good. You could just feel like half the stuff, it just feels so natural, like it just comes off the tip of his tongue.
Yeah.
Like, that's not in the script, the way he's acting right now.
No.
It's just the energy that he brings. It just makes, it just works so well with that character because it's like it's supposed to be this buzzing kind of insect that's just non-stop on sugar.
How big was Jeff Goldblum before this?
I mean, what was his big film before this? I feel like this is what maybe put him
or like made him into that kind of character, like the character he is. Like, he might have been in other stuff, but this is the first film where he's like, this is Jeff Goldblum. This is what when I think of Jeff Goldblum as an actor, this is what I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Let's have a look. What had he done before that was big? I feel like this was his big thing, and it probably helped that he wasn't very well known beforehand, because I imagine audiences probably bought him as this eccentric scientist because they hadn't seen him doing the Jeff Goldblum thing before. Let's see. I mean, he'd done a bunch of TV. He'd done Buckaroo Banzai, but he wasn't big enough in Buckaroo Banzai. The Big Chill.
Still need to see that.
Annie Hall, but just as a party guest. Yeah, he hadn't really been a lead in anything. So yeah, his very first film was Death Wish. He played Freak Number One.
What, with Charles Bronson?
Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
12 years before The Fly.
Mm. Yeah, I think it's definitely put him on the map.
Definitely 100%, yeah.
Yeah.
Great. It is great stuff. What of the abortion angle?
So I love that whole scene because it gives us it without... So obviously it's very over the top and silly, right? If they had it in the film, but because it's a dream, it almost like, of course, yeah, it looks, that's wonderful. It gets so silly, this massive worm, like maggot thing coming out.
But it's like,
you get the horror of it, but you don't have to link it to like, oh, now we're breaking away from reality. Even though you see this massive fly at the end.
Yeah.
So like, if it was a little bit too far, having a maggot baby.
It kind of works, though. I like the fact that David Cronenberg is a gynecologist, because apparently Gina Davis said the only way that I'll do this scene is if you played a gynecologist, because she was uncomfortable with that setup. Because she was uncomfortable with being in that position and just casting some random person to play the gynecologist. So she's like, I trust you, David. You be this person.
Pull that maggot out of me.
Pull it out. But I mean, like, broadly, like, sort of broadly speaking about the abortion, I think this is... I'm leaving my big thing, my big analogy for the film until we talk about the more obvious stuff, because I don't want it to colour everything else. But in terms of the abortion thing, what I thought was interesting here is that this is a film from the 80s that was... essentially saying this should be the fucking woman's choice, because she's uncomfortable with having the child, right? She wants an abortion. The one guy, the father, is going, oh, please don't kill a part of me, basically. If you abort it, you destroy me completely, there'll be nothing left of me. And the other one is like, oh, you're a bit upset at the moment, give it a few days, like taking away her agency when it should be her fucking choice that she wants to do it. And I liked the fact that it dealt with not explicitly, but it showed the two men as being fucking weak in them not allowing the woman to decide what she wants to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
I also appreciated that guy's facial expression when he finds out she's pregnant, and at first he's like,
yeah, he's like
surprised. He's like, oh. Then he's like happy it's not his.
And then thinks about really what's going to happen. It's like, oh, wait.
I know.
While he was a fly?
I know. And that is the thing. I mean, we will never know, because we won't talk about that sequel, but we'll never know if she has that child what it would have been like.
One thing, though, talking about that, it almost confused me into thinking maybe she wasn't pregnant, because of the fact that it leads on to a dreamlike sequence with the whole, it's almost like, oh, it's weeks down the line, right?
Yeah.
I felt after when she wakes up, oh, is she actually pregnant? Because I don't think they speak about it again until at the end when she goes to confront him.
But it's also quite near the end, though.
It's true, but I think it almost confuses me a little bit that whether she was actually pregnant or not.
She was
pregnant, yes. But I'm just saying, because it was a dream, I was wondering, well, was that scene just before that a dream?
I think dream, the scene where pregnant. They go to the gynecologist, or whoever that is, and they're talking about it, and he's like, yeah, the father is a disabled man. We have reason to suspect, blah, blah. I think all that's real. It's the moment that she's wheeled out in the wheelchair before going into surgery that I think the dream has kicked in.
Yeah.
And I think as well, that is... out of everything, that feels like the first true moment of horror, where everything else before it, you almost, there's still a level of sympathy there from Gina Davis, regardless of like him vomiting up and stuff. It's all like, it's funny and it's disgusting, but it's never horrific until we get to this, where she literally gives birth to this maggot and the horror in everyone's face, and you're like, oh my God, this is horrendous. I think it's a proper first moment of horror, and then from then on, that is just pure horror from everything else, I feel.
Yeah.
Because it's all about feeling empathetic for this man.
All right, well, okay. So let's have a bit of this then.
Come on.
So here's my read on it this time. I have seen this countless times. In fact, the last time I saw this, I went with Ginny. We went to the Prince Charles cinema to see it. I feel like it was Halloween one year.
Can I say where you might be getting some of your ideas from?
Go on.
A moment, because I was thinking, well, this, he's definitely trying to say something here. Is it when he's speaking about you're not comfortable with the flesh and everything like this?
A bit of that, yeah.
Yeah.
But we'll see.
Okay, come.
Maybe. When I went and saw this with Jenny at the Prince Charles many years ago, the audience was packed, and throughout the film, they were laughing at almost everything that happened, and pretty much en masse, pretty much everyone was doing it. And I was so cross, because it was the first time that Jenny had seen it, and I'm like, this is not, there are funny moments, sure, obviously, but this is not a comedy movie. And if you are laughing all the way through this, every time something happens, you are missing the point.
Well, even him like crawling on the ceiling and all that kind of stuff.
But it's not, okay.
That's what I mean, that's
not
funny.
You don't laugh out loud about it, but it's more like every time a line was said, or every time some situation happened, like people were cracking up every time they saw the next stage in Jeff Goldblum's transformation. It's like, it's not always funny. There is a dark humor.
Was it like
throughout
one group of people that started it, or was it just?
It was the whole Prince Charles, and it was the downstairs bit Prince Charles, which is big. It's not small upstairs screen. It's the downstairs one.
Yeah, but I mean, was it like one group of people that started the laughing and everyone joined in, or was it like everyone from the beginning?
I can't remember. But the point is,
I think that's a sign of just those type of screenings where you have these massive fans of the film. Like if you went and saw anything of a massive cult following, it's like if you go to see Rocky Horror. Obviously, it's a very different thing. Everyone's shouting out and getting really involved in it because they know it so well. I feel like it's maybe that same kind of energy for The Fly, but on a lower scale.
I hated it, and it further compounded the belief that I'm right and the majority is wrong when it comes to film. I know that is very snobbish behaviour, but I stand
you
by
just
I
sound
think
that,
people.
You just need to clip that up, Paul, and just make that the whole episode of the film out of context.
It's fine. I'm not. I don't care. I know that I'm right. So anyway, the point was, up to that point, I'm like, why are people like, what is it that is making all these people fucking love this thing rather than take it seriously? And it's because people are unwilling to engage beyond the surface of what they're getting in it, because they're just taking surface. They know there is something else there, but they're not willing to access it, or they don't want to access it. If you don't want to, fine. If you're not willing, well, that's a weakness on your half. Here is what this film is about for me, and I really cemented it on this viewing. It is about the weakness of men on both sides. It is Jeff Goldblum and it is her editor. What relationships can do to a man, what it does to a man's identity, what it does to a man when a woman breaks up with him or leaves him. Case in point, Jeff Goldblum, normal guy until he meets Gina Davis. We can assume he's possibly a virgin or fairly virginal. He's a bit of a geek. He doesn't really understand other people, just the way he talks. He's a scientist. He's disconnected from the world. He's a bit of an oddball. He has sex with Gina Davis, enters into a relationship with her. Then he's at that moment when she leaves him to go to her ex, when he discovers that she has gone to her ex, he goes through the machine and transforms. The transformation is his weakness as a man, his jealousy, his insecurity, his potential controlling nature. All of that is embodied in his transformation after that. At the same time, the other guy, and then it proceeds as the film goes on. It just keeps consuming him, the effect of this relationship. On the other hand, this other guy, we see him being weak. Like, he comes around her house, jumping in her shower. He wants to get back with her. He falls on his knees like, oh, please take me back kind of thing. He feels emasculated. his body by the end. He's lost a foot and he's lost a hand in the pursuit of kind of redeeming himself. It's all about how these two guys in this kind of triangle with her have just become totally corrupted by their petty jealousies and insecurities and the things that they want at the expense of her. And this is why I think it is ultimately about what a relationship can do to your identity, because you think you know who you are as an individual. You couple with someone, you twin with someone, you fuse with someone like he wants at the end. You go in there and I go in there and then we come out together there with the baby. What about who you are without that? And it's the inability to be an individual once you have fused with another person, what it can do to you. I think it is a romantic film. I do think it has a romance and a real love between them at its heart, but I think it is showing the how little emotions can really pollute a relationship and pollute how you see yourself, because you start feeling insecure and whatnot. I think both men are incredibly, incredibly weak. I think Gina Davis is the only strong person in this film.
I think there
is something in there, 100%.
That is a wonderful reading of it. Absolutely, I can see that for sure. Brilliant.
It kind of felt right on this view, because every time. It's no coincidence. Why did I spend so much time sort of setting up this ex that she was with? And it's no coincidence that he goes through immediately after talking about jealousy. And then when he comes out of the pod and they have an argument, you know, that he starts evolving, feels stronger at first because he's had sex with her. So he feels stronger. He's cocky, as you say. But then he's like, you're jealous. You're jealous. I'm doing this. I'm doing that. It's like, no, you're the jealous one, mate. It's come from you.
Feels like he has to rebel off and go find another woman.
Yeah.
But that's not actually what he wants.
It's a very good reading of the film.
It's one reading. And it breaks the question. It's an interesting question, because it is essentially identity. And it is like you understand who you were before you met Zoe. You understand who you were before you met Chelsea, right? You were a individual that existed without that person. You got into a relationship with this person. You fell in love with this person. Now you are coupled and twinned with that person. Are you the same person as before? Who are you now? Taking away the fact that you are with this other person, but who are you?
I personally would say I'm still the same person.
You are.
I haven't lost myself.
You haven't lost yourself, but it's changed. You just changed another. You've got like another arm on you almost.
Sorry, yeah. I mean,
you
feels
live
like
stuff
that
through her now. You live what she wants, you like all the stuff that she's added.
Well, it's a thing you pick up along the way, because I've got two kids now. But have I changed because I've got two kids? Maybe. I changed when. Maybe you can say I'm different when I'm with the person.
Yeah.
And then when I'm doing this podcast now, I'm exactly the same person that I was before, just with a different mindset of the things I've been through those times.
There would be a evolution of the self that would have definitely
happened.
You
still look at stuff in different ways even when you're by yourself, though. You don't look at everything the same way. That's probably just from getting old as much as it's from anything else.
And that too. Yeah, that's why I like this film so much, because it's all of that. It's about aging as well. It is just about getting older and realizing that your body is not who you are. Because the minute that all his bits start falling off and he starts losing himself, like, is he that same person? At what point does he not become that person anymore?
I just love how there's a fine balance between being a fly and being like a superhuman before.
Well, yeah, he can certainly snap arms like the best of them.
But love, I think there's definitely something there, as you say, from where you're coming from, because it feels so intrinsic to the whole story, this relationship and his relationship to Gina Davis. It is like so part of his evolution and his relationship with her, and she is the most strongest person, because she has she always makes her choice to be there to still be seeing him and to try and be helping him, and
yeah
she's she's always has her own agency, and
she certainly always does, and she never just does something for someone else. Like, but you know, when he calls her up after that month break and he's like, I need to see you, I'm not doing very well, she could have been scared and timid. She wasn't. She went because there was a love there. There was a connection there.
A strength.
You could say it comes very quickly. You could say their relationship is rushed through, and maybe there's a little bit of truth to that at the beginning. It seems very quick, but it's also believable, I think.
Mm-hmm. There is, it does very, because I don't really know how much time has passed. You don't know how long they've been in this relationship, really. And because I feel like it does feel like they've known each other for a long time, or like Gina Davis hadn't been there for a little while, because he seems like, oh, you come back.
Yeah.
Like, it's been a while, and the disrepair in his apartment, it's clearly been a while. But then who's bringing him donuts?
Well, Jenny said that, but...
he's got Deliveroo before Deliveroo was Deliveroo.
Perhaps. But isn't the bigger question who's bringing him baboons? Forget the donuts.
Also, even back in the 80s, I still don't think I'd be having a baboon next to that close to my face. Aren't they renowned for just going absolutely tits for no reason?
They're meant to be very violent.
Yeah, for no reason.
They are.
Like horses.
That little one ran out of the machine, though, and jumped straight into his arms.
Yeah, but still, it takes one thing for him to go and rip your face off.
Yeah.
By all accounts, it was a very volatile baboon on set, and Jeff Goldblum had to command its respect. And he was, along with the trainer, only Jeff Goldblum could really get the respect of this thing, but it was really volatile.
I was about to say.
I can imagine you want to have built a relationship with that wild animal.
Yes. Sure. I must say, I'm very glad that there was a scene that was not filmed, or if it was filmed, was decided not to include. There was a scene where Jeff puts a baboon and a cat in the transporter, and it fuses, and it's so hideous, so he has to beat it to death with a pipe.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, that's a little bit too much.
Did they film it, you say?
I don't know, but I remember Cronenberg said, if we include this in the film, the audience will absolutely lose all sympathy for him, and it's true.
Mm-hmm. You would have lost. Would you give it like a 6 out of 10?
I would rank it down for sure, because it's completely unnecessary.
Yeah, absolutely.
So
did they film other endings? I know you said mentioned about endings.
I don't think they were filmed. I think they were written and largely considered. Maybe they were filmed, because I heard something about Jeff Goldblum being cross if one ending was. Hang on, let me just check this so that we can just say once and for all if it was actually filmed. Yeah, okay, it was filmed. So the two endings was one, she gives birth to her baby after the events of the film. She gives birth to it, and it's born with butterfly wings. So it's a beautiful baby. So a kind of happy ending. I know, horrible.
Okay. No.
But the other one is Ronnie, wakes up next to her ex, who she's now married to, and is pregnant with his child. And the revelation is it was his child and not Jeff Goldblum's.
Oh, no. No. It ended exactly what it should have done.
It did. It did.
Didn't need that.
Didn't need that. And I like that his identity literally ends with the film. Like, it is it's a jarring ending. Blows his brains out in a devastating way. I had tears. I have had for the last few times I've watched it, but I had tears the other day. And blows his brains out, and the film ends there in that tragic way. Because that's the end of Brundle. That's the end of Seth. Who he was is gone. We don't need to see anything else now.
Yeah, it is horrible. Him bringing that gun up to his head.
It is.
He knows it was gone too far gone. When he's got a door halfway in him.
I know. Such a mental, absolutely mental last move, isn't it? To merge him with the machine.
That's
but Cronenberg loves this stuff.
So Cronenberg. Yeah.
But that's why I think that this is his best, because in all his films he explores this obsession with the flesh and what it means to be human and how we transform and connect and exist in the world. This is his best one of the flesh. It is the obsession with the flesh is the obsession with the self.
Did you ever watch that
new
one?
It's the obsession with not changing. No, I haven't seen it yet.
That is very much obsession with the flesh.
It always has been.
I don't actually like it when he goes on about the merging of technology and the flesh, though. Like, I'm not into the Videodrome and stuff like that.
No, you're not.
Doesn't do anything for me. No. But this is very much on my street. I just like the visceral. It is flesh, just flesh transforming. That does it better for me. Merging of technology, it's like, doesn't do anything for me.
Yeah, but it comes through technology. I know what you mean. Yeah, but it comes through technology.
It's part. It's part of this. Yeah, it's part of the transformation. Yeah, but
there is something that I only ever clocked on this watch, and I was like, oh, is that going to pay off later? And it never does. Now, see if you boys, you go back and play it and see what you think. Mm. When he very first time he has her over to the house and he puts her stock in the transformer, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
He gives a voice command to the computer. I can't remember what it is. He gives a voice command to it, right?
And he whispers.
He whispers.
Yeah.
What the fuck's that?
It never pays off. Because I think he says something like teleport or something like that. So he doesn't want her to hear what this thing's going to do.
Oh, okay.
So it's just giving a command, so she's surprised by what
happens.
Doesn't
he type everything in?
Not at that point.
He has to start typing it in
once his voice fails him.
Yeah. But the machine needs commands, so it's only him who can instruct the machine what to do. Just for, like, I guess, security purposes. So nothing goes wrong. But it does go wrong.
Those and the other thing about the machine itself, the pods, they feel very womb-like, very similar in aesthetic to the eggs in Aliens, right?
Yeah.
Which, again, goes to this idea of men's control over reproduction, wanting ownership over what can
and can't be
born.
I swear we say this
every
single year that we do a film, it's always about pigs, basically.
Yeah, because we are. Even when men are the ones telling the story. And this is the thing, unconsciously, whether these people know they're doing it or not, it is psycho. Was I saying this to you the other day, Paul, or was I saying it to Jenny? It's not, even if you ask the director, is this what you meant? They might go, well, no. But it's like, you were unconsciously doing it, you didn't realise. Like, lots of us do things we don't realise we're doing unconsciously because of who we are, what our experience is. It was you, Paul. We were talking about Spielberg, the daddy issues.
Yeah.
Like, Spielberg doesn't know that he has daddy issues, but he puts daddy issues in all of his films. Mm. In this, the aesthetic, it's a choice to make those pods kind of womb-like. And it is Brundle basically going, I will control what is born here.
I will control
what comes out of this. Yeah, I will have ownership over it, not the woman. The woman, yeah, well. And I'm sure there's lots of other discussions that could be had about gender fluidity and whatnot in this day and age in it, but I'm not best placed to be the spokesperson for that.
Mm. But it kind of does make sense with Gina being pregnant at the end, and it's all about her choice whether she wants to or not, and no one else can kind of make that choice for her.
Yes, exactly.
As much as people want to.
Yeah. It's a very devastating ending, because despite seeing all this, he is a sympathetic character, but he is an enemy of his own.
Yeah, he's killed himself effectively.
He has.
Yeah.
Because whether it was
desire has killed him.
Yeah. It was his scientific desire to rush into that machine, but it happened at the exact same moment that he was incredibly jealous of the fact that she went to her ex. So whether it was scientific ambition or a bit of toxic masculinity, jealousy, it corrupted him completely.
Mm. Absolutely.
And there is 100% a thing of identity changing the minute you merge with someone. It's a whole conversation about identity anyway, which many academics have written books on beyond me. But 100%, if you'd never met Zoe Ball, you would not be who you are right now.
Zoe Ball.
If I hadn't met Jenny, I wouldn't be who I was. If you hadn't met Chelsea, you wouldn't be who you were. If you would be the same, that's not a good thing, right? Because it means
they would have sacrificed themselves.
Yeah. You grow, you evolve, you change. You have to.
It's true, yeah. You soften, you harden. You evolve together.
Then you have children.
You don't evolve on your own. That's where it gets.
Yeah, toxic. I mean, I suppose you can a bit, but like, yeah.
A different type of evolution.
Mm.
And more people are happy by themselves.
That's good. I'm loving those readings. Yeah, that's very.
There was one other little reading, but it wasn't a big thing, but it was kind of interesting. I thought is that Gina Davis is like a grunt, and Jeff Goldblum is like a grunt because both of them don't actually own their work. Like Jeff Goldblum has these financial backers who are like, yeah, "We don't care what you're doing, but here's the money to do it." But actually, they would have control over the intellectual property of this whole thing, I think. And Gina Davis, she works for that magazine, but it's actually the magazine and the boss who own the story, not her.
Yeah, and they control whether they want to use the story or not, and when they want to push it out. Yeah,
little grunts,
little grunts, little maggots,
little maggots. But there's a whole, there's so much that could be said in this thing, man. It's a joy of a film, but in a very dark, horrible way. It's a horror
definitely not in the traditional sense. Definitely not funny.
It has its funny moments, things that make you laugh,
but
for sure.
Not all the time.
No.
No.
Not laugh out loud in the cinema every moment.
No. No, definitely not.
The best horror films have funny moments.
They do. It's to make you uncomfortable.
Yeah, you need to sit uncomfortable. Yeah. Him spewing up on those donuts, man, that's great.
I know.
Gross, but great.
And the fact that he goes, oh, that's disgusting.
And I'm sure he, because in that moment, it cuts away from the screen, but he said, and this is how I actually eat it back up. And I imagined surely some kind of spout comes out of his mouth or something.
Yeah, yeah. And you just see the guy's reaction.
I thought a long tongue.
Or a tongue, yeah, something like that.
Such a brilliant film.
What out of everything gross that happens, what is the thing that grosses you out the most?
I think it's his face towards the end when it's all like, I think it's when he loses his teeth. That is quite.
Yeah, the teeth thing is pretty horrific. I think his squirting of his fingernail.
That does it for me. Over
the mirror. Yeah.
Mm. Any fingernails falling off, it always, because it feels like something that can just happen to you. Like, my head's not going to split open, as fly's not going to come out, but my nail might fall off.
You hope not, it might happen.
I hope it doesn't.
And the teeth is...
Yeah, teeth horrible. They just fall out, don't they? But how do they fall out?
He has a pencil in his mouth while he's thinking. They just fall down over his keyboard, and he adds them to the museum. He's like, you're a relic.
I love how he's got to a point where all these things are falling off. He's just like, it's just another thing. It's just another thing that's come off.
Yeah. He has his balls in there as well. My favourite moment of the film, apart from the ending, but my favourite is the line following the insect politics thing, which is like, I don't know what you're talking about. And he says that great line. He says, I'm an insect who dreamed he was a man and loved it, but now the dream is over and the insect is awake. That is great. Excellent.
Such a great line. And I think this is just to show as well, like, he does care about Gina Davis because he's trying to tell her, this is, you need to stay away from me because
I'll hurt you.
Insects are ruthless and there's no kind of sympathetic thing towards them. So as soon as I make that change,
passion,
it's over.
Yeah. Yeah, my humanity is gone.
Yeah, it'd be stripped away and it'd be gone.
But then all of that goes out the window when he finds out he might be a father. And he's like, actually, let me smash through the fucking glass and steal you away to make you have that baby.
Yeah.
That's a bit toxic.
It's true, yeah, yeah. But again,
I guess it's more of him trying to live on, though, rather than he knows he's dying and the only way he can live on is through that child.
I know, but at the expense of a woman who doesn't want to. Yeah.
But at the same time, this comes after he has that speech, so maybe the change has happened where
the insect's taking over more.
Set in, yeah.
Yeah. I want to be the first insect politician.
It is probably the greatest scene in the film. Just because of how it's, you just see how how far gone he's gone. Mm. And Gina Davis's face when he's saying this, like, man, he just wants to be this insect now.
Yeah.
That's it. It's too far gone. But also the fear of, but I'm scared I won't be able to be that politician because I'll have no humanity left to even be that.
Well, yeah,
have no humanity anyway.
Yeah.
It's a very tragic thing. Very, very tragic thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And it is cautionary. Do not fuck with science, as you say.
Mm-hmm. I think there's just one line as well that always sits with me. It's kind of throwaway, but it kind of adds a nice little punch. And it's when he just sings, no, no, lady who swallowed a fly, perhaps she'll die.
Mm.
And it's like he knows that the end might be coming at this point. And it's like, oh, man.
He should have swallowed a spider to catch the fly.
That's what he should have done. Imagine, just put the spider in with me.
And then you get a cat to get the spider. The dog is
some like hybrid animal man.
Yeah. But here's one thing that I have to say, because it's funny how this aligns. The fly is now connected to two other great podcasts that we listen to. Movie Drone just released an episode on the fly, which is great.
Because it was his birthday, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. They released it on Jeff's birthday, 71.
We weren't that proactive.
I know.
71, man.
Nuts. And also, the very first Contrarians episode I ever listened to was when they released The Fly.
I didn't realize they did The Fly.
They did The Fly, and the reason I think I told this story at the time when they came on as guests. The reason I remember that one so well is my granddad had just died, and I was like sort of looking for, you know, distraction and whatnot. So I was looking at other podcasts and found theirs, and they had just released that episode that week, and I remember it being like, oh, this is nice, this is fun, this is nice conversation at a bleak time. So shout out to them as well.
Aww. Contrarians, we love you.
We love
still
the
Contrarians. Distracting
and Movie
you to
Drone,
this day.
We love you.
Still distracting to this day. We do. Anyway, both Mark and Steve gave The Fly. They do their marks out of 100. I think Mark said something like 70 something. Late 70s, and Steve was more like 82, 83. I look forward to seeing where you boys are going to land.
What, you want to do that now?
Unless you've got anything else to say, I'm happy to do it now.
No, I'm happy to do it now. Solid 9 out of 10.
9
it's not
out of 10.
It's not making the 10, but it's a 9 out of 10. It was 8. It was 8 before, but it's gone to the 9 now. Yeah.
Well, that's a good leap.
Yeah, it's one of those films that's a bit weird for me. It's like, I can't fault it, but for some reason, it doesn't make it beyond an 8. It kind of just sets in that realm. Normally those films go to an 8, but for some reason this one, I don't know why, it just sits on that 8 for me. It's a very close to a 9.
That's fine.
I think maybe I would hazard a guess, Adam, that it might be because ultimately horror isn't entirely your bag, and there's horrific elements in it that make it.
I mean, I don't care. It's just like it's I can't fault it for being a film. It just some reason it doesn't resonate with me beyond an 8.
Yeah,
that's all right.
You know when it gets to the 9.
That's all right. Well, check it out, boys. That averages the film out at a 9 out of 10.
Well, did you give it a 10?
I give it a 10.
You didn't ever said that. You just said that.
I did at the beginning of the episode. You know where I stand, baby. I said it was better than Aliens. So for the second week in a row, we have a film going into our top 20.
Wow.
1986. Hell of a year. So it averages at 9. Boys, here we go. Better or worse than One Night in Miami? Better for me.
Better.
Better or worse than Clockwork Orange? Better for me.
I'd say Clockwork is better.
Oh, shit.
All to decide.
Oh, man. Oh.
It's a big call, that one. It's a big call.
That is a massive call.
Yes.
I might interest to see how far it goes.
Well, no, you don't have to play that game. Just be honest.
I know.
It's not better than Clockwork, you can...
The fact of the matter is, both rewatches of these films elevated to a 9.
Uh-huh.
I had them both on an 8 before. So they're both worthy of contending.
Which is worthier, Kubrick or Cronenberg? Goldblum or McDowell?
Fly goes above. It's got more rewatchability. It's harder to watch Clockwork.
Nocturnal Animals is better than Nocturnal.
Nocturnal is better for me.
Better than Nocturnal.
Here's where it ends for you, Paul. Face Off.
Yeah, doesn't beat Face Off.
It's better than Face Off for me. What about for you, Adam?
I would say it's better than Face Off.
Oh, well, it goes above Face Off. And it, check this out. Casino. I think it's better than Casino. It is better than Casino.
It's not Casino.
It's not better than Casino.
Okay. Well, that's a very good run. It is our new number 12. Above Face Off, but below Casino. And that pushes Jamie's RoboCop out of our top 20.
Goodbye, RoboCop.
Goodbye, RoboCop. Dr. Sleep
see
is the new number 20. We're shaking things up this year, boy.
We are, jeez.
We are shaking things up. I'm very happy with that. Good
stuff,
Paul.
Yeah, very good. Yeah, great stuff. Wow. Well, Adam, what we got next?
Yes, so you ready?
I think so.
Are we not doing no patron thing first? Oh, yeah, we did a film. I keep forgetting this.
Yeah, we do this first.
So this film came out in 1986, obviously.
Should hope so.
I don't know what else to say about this film. I don't know a lot. It's got John Goodman in it.
I don't know what it is.
John Goodman.
It's about a small but growing Texas town filled with strange musical characters celebrates its... I don't know how to say that word.
Coverage on a
local parade on a talent show. David Byrne is the main character.
Oh.
What? Wow.
It's called True Stories.
Wow, this is a fucking curveball from you. What is this?
It's not a curveball.
A 4 out of 10, but everyone else has it really high.
I'm not even going to look into what it's about because I didn't understand your description anyway, so I'm not even going to look into it. But where can it be seen, Adam?
We're probably going to have to rent this film on YouTube. I did look at it and it was on YouTube to rent and stuff. So,
True Stories.
True Story. What a curveball.
That is a curveball. Wow. I've never even heard of it.
Nor have I until... It's on my watch list for some reason, but I didn't know about it until I went onto my watch list to see what films I had.
That'll be because of David Byrne, though, right?
Yeah. He directed it as well.
Oh, David Byrne directed it? Oh, yeah, it's definitely going to be a musical
film. It's about a talent show or by a local parade and talent shows. It's going to be weird characters and a talent show.
I recognise the poster.
That's going to push up John Goodman in my all-timers because John Goodman's already in my most watched actors of all time.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is going to be interesting. Clocking it at 89 minutes as well.
Yeah.
Oh, good. Short, another sweet. Nice, tight one. Very good. Mm.
Well, good one, Adam. Didn't expect that.
No, didn't expect it at all.
Well, what did I?
Should we move on to what our patrons have to say this week?
Yeah, may as well see what those people want to say.
Okay.
I get the money's worth out of us every.
Basically, our patrons, they let us know what they're watching, the best and the worst of the past week, and we speak about them and say whether we agree and then shoot them down or we uplift them. So it should be. You can get all that content at www.patreon.com/filmbusters and become part of the family, just like the likes of Luke Bennett.
Yes, you can. You can also join Francis Ciborini.
You can also join Andy Bishop.
You can also join Steve and Mark. Go check out their Fly episode.
Yes, you can. You can join Brent from Home Video Hustle.
You can join Luke Human.
You can join Mr. Nerd Revert.
Yeah, you can. You also got Julio from The Contrarians.
You got Jamie, who started us off with 1986's Aliens.
And you got Katie in OT. There we go. So, and only of all, we've got Mr. Luke Human, who basically said, "The good 2016's The Belko Experiment, a white-collar worker battle royale that knows exactly what it's doing and manages to maintain the logic of its world. There's little to seriously consider here, and the tone is more reminiscent of Cabin in the Woods than its Japanese predecessor. But for those that have spent time in office environments, there's something delicious about the carnage that ensues." The Belko Experiment. Anyone seen that?
I think I have. Is it the one where they give them power and stuff like that and people just go absolutely mental?
Is that where they're in prison, where people are guards and people are... I have seen the Belko Experiment. Yeah, I have seen it.
Yeah.
It's when they're in an office building, yeah.
That's right.
But some people get put in charge.
Yes?
I can't remember if some people... It was a fine film. It was a good film. I can't remember the details about it. It was a case of, like, survive in this office. We're locking the doors down. Not all of you are going to make it out of here alive type thing.
And everyone's killing each other and stuff.
That's right.
They?
Yeah. It was as Luke says, kind of like a battle royale style office building setting. Yeah, it was good. I remember it was good.
I remember you telling me to watch it.
Well, I didn't love it though.
I remember you saying, "Oh, something really good happens at the end," but I can't remember what it was.
Oh, Mate, I wish I could remember what that was as well. I don't know.
Who knows? But we remember kind of liking it, Luke, so you're probably correct. He says the bad, 2022's Pearl, so the sequel to X. This is a lot of effort to go for what is essentially a backstory for a pretty average homage to 70s horror. It reeks of vanity. It reeks of a vanity project, and while it works stylistically, nicely invoking studio output of the 30s, the caged bird aspect is overhammed. Goth, however, continues to grow in my estimation, and it's easy to see why she and Wes developed this. I'm hopeful for Maxine, but we'll need it to be something more dynamic to give the trilogy substance.
Not interested whatsoever. That Mia Goth is the most overrated horror person right now. Everyone is losing their mind over her. She's no good.
Well, guess what?
What?
I'm speaking about it in our monthly roundup this week.
What, Pearl?
Well, yep. I certainly hope it's your worst.
Can you insert that clip of Ben saying, I'm right, everyone else is wrong about me?
Yeah. Can I just have a button that plays that?
So, I guess if you want to hear my thoughts, you're going to have to see the patrons. So, yeah. Sign up if you want to hear that. And that's it. That's our patrons.
We'll discuss it there. Excellent. Good. Well, true stories is where we go to next.
True stories. What a curveball.
What absolute curveball. I'm not going to look into it at all.
No, same. So that's going to be a musical, right?
Yeah, I feel like it. You know what? It's going to be like Pink Floyd's The Wall kind of thing. It'll be like a story, but with a bunch of songs all the way through. Not like a typical musical.
I don't
musical.
Know necessarily, but I think it might be more of like an ending of a, like 8 Mile or something like that.
8 Mile,
David Byrne rapping on stage.
No, but you know what I mean, it's not all about music. There's what heavy musical moments and acts, but not all about.
Well, mate, I'm looking forward to it. That's an absolute curveball. You've gone against time. See, what normally happens is you like to sometimes hit the big boys, but because we've come out of the traps running with aliens and fly, you've decided no, this is too big.
And that's what you guys said to me as well. You were like, are we going to go big the whole way here? And I was like, I feel like this is a fairly big and not big film. Like, as soon as I typed in Google, like, films of 1986, it was like the fourth film that came up as well.
Interesting. Like, well, that's cool. That's
I feel
cool.
like it's just, it might be an American kind of thing, but I don't think it's like completely under the radar of, like, enough people in my letterbox have seen it.
I look forward to it.
Absolutely. Well, thanks everyone. The Fly was wonderful. And that's what you got to look forward to next. Other than that, come over to the Patreon and join in the fun.
Join in the fun. See you there.
Goodbye.